folks, welcome back to another episode of Throat Punch Lunch. Episode 2 is called Moving Out. Now, the whole idea behind moving out is that now I'm just kind of letting the reins loose on my contributors, letting them do pretty much what they want to do, try to get comfortable in their own little segments and that kind of thing. The whole original lineup of contributors is returning for episode 2, plus I've got a couple more contributors that emailed me and wanted to see if they could get in on the action, and I liked their episodes, I liked their segments, so we're going to go ahead and give them a try as well. Hopefully you'll enjoy that. The whole idea here is that we're just showing another side of our hobby, a side of our hobby that has kind of been overlooked a little bit, but it's still there, it's still lively, and it's still vibrant. So we're going to take a look at all that, but hey, without further ado, let's go ahead and get to our contributors. You're not here to listen to me blather, so let's get to it.
This is me, Undead Viking, and this is Ameritrash Treasures on the Throat Punch Lunch. You have absolutely no idea how tough it is for me to make these short videos, so all I'm going to say is this is Supremacy. It's an old school game. It's going back through Kickstarter, and it is amazing. Alright, this is Supremacy, and I remember the very first time I ever saw this board. It was in the living room of my buddy Justin Chardon's house when he invited me over to play this because he told me that it was going to be Axis and Allies with nuclear weapons. And I said, sign me up! And then I got over there, and I was like, this doesn't look like Axis and Allies with nuclear weapons. This looks like some weird, bad computer 80s art. But it was a very awesome game. I remember playing it. I remember being destroyed as South America, and I was very sad. But regardless, this is a game about global domination. You can play the game other ways as well, and there are variants. But the basic game is destroying everybody else, either by taking over their countries, bombing them back into the Stone Age, or bankrupting them because they just can't stay afloat, you know, because it does cost money to run a superpower. All right, so there were a lot of cool things about the game, but why is this an Ameritrash treasure? I mean, like, basically, look at it. I mean, this game is very stark. It has dice. It has, I mean, it doesn't have units, which was kind of neat. You know, I was like, well, what do you mean? These are my armies? I mean, it was a predecessor to the cubes. Isn't that kind of cool? And it did have this cool market as well. Like, you would buy and sell things, and these would flow back and forth. You'd probably play tons of games that have that as well, you know, economics or whatever. But this game was about conflict. This is about moving your forces into somebody else's other nation and having them defend against your onrush of attack. And it wasn't a situation where, like, you rolled the dice and a 5 or 6 or a 6 or whatever was a success. This was you roll dice, and depending upon, like, if you had the majority of the... Like, defenders would get 2 dice, attackers would get 1 die, and then if you had more units than you were attacking, you got... or more units than you're defending, for that matter, you got an extra dice... die, if you will. If you had more laser satellites, which are a thing that can defend you against nuclear weapons, you got an extra die, and then you would just roll a dice, and the attackers would roll, and then they got a 6, and so for every multiple of 6 you get, you destroy a unit, so you take those up, and then the defenders would go, and they got a 7, so they'd defend, and you'd go back and forth. And the cool thing was, actually, is that when somebody got attacked, they were allowed to do a counterattack, which meant that they were able to, like, attack anybody. And they can even throw a nuke at somebody. You know, so there was all kinds of cool things. And of course, since I brought up nukes, yes, they have these cute little mushroom clouds that you use to blow people up. And on your turn, you could decide, I'm going to, you know what, bye-bye, Brazil! And you'd say, I'm going to nuke that. The only way to defend it was having L-Star technology, which you actually got by going through this deck and speculating. You'd say, I want to find, like, you can find resources. You could say, I want to find oil. And then, oh, well, there you go, oil. So you'd find this cool spot with oil. You'd show everybody this part of the card saying that you had found an oil card. You'd pay money to do that. And then you'd know if you ever took over Arabia, you would eventually, you know, have, like, this giant oil deposit, if you will. You know, but you'd have to research nukes to get them, and you would have to research your L-Stars as well to get them. And once you got them, you were able to purchase them. They cost a lot of money and resources, but you would then increase these little things. And this was one of the first games I ever played that basically had a bunch of little trackers that you would move these little discs up back and forth to show what you had. You know, it had two last things, actually. It had money, paper money, obviously, paper money, but they went up to $1 billion. How cool is that? And the other cool thing that we always argued over who had to be North America. Not because, you know, America or anything like that, but because we lived in Fargo, North Dakota. And Fargo, North Dakota is right on the border of Minnesota. And on the other side of Fargo, North Dakota, there is a town that I live in presently, and that is Moorhead, Minnesota. And it had this. The North America had the Moorhead Mines in Midwest USA, which was really cool. And, you know, it was kind of neat that, like, one of our little towns was mentioned in this game that came out. So, I mean, there you go. I mean, it has its flaws. It has its problems. You know, they fixed a lot of those in, the tons of expansions they came out with, which are tough to find. So I'm really hoping that the Kickstarter or whatever that kind of is bringing this game back, once it finally is published and created, I'm really hoping that, like, maybe they can get the other those other cool expansions that were out there and add to it. Because the game, in my mind, it's a throwback, but it's something that some of the best friends I ever made in my entire life were made sitting at a table, and they were across the table playing this game. So a lot of great memories, a lot of great, feels, if you will. But anyway, there you go. That's Supremacy. That's Ameritrash Treasures. You have yourself one heck of an awesome day. All right, bye-bye.
Hey folks, welcome back to another segment of The Canvas, my little spot on Throat Punch Lunch, where I'm going to be showcasing different people from around the world that use the hobby in some way to enrich their lives. You know, last week or last episode, we were looking at a family in Belgium that used painting miniatures as a family activity over the weekend. And this week, we're actually looking at another couple that are using painting to spend some quality time together. I got an email from Melissa Furnish, and she says that her and her boyfriend like to spend time together painting their Warhammer 40K miniatures, and they're college students, and so there's a lot of stress that goes on there, but then they like to just have a date night and paint miniatures together and swap ideas off of one another. They just like to chill out, hang out with each other, and paint miniatures. And as you've been seeing, this is the product of their romantic evenings in. And so I just thought it was pretty cool that they were willing to share that with us. So kudos to Dustin and Melissa for taking time, chilling out, and just enjoying painting models together. So that is the canvas for this segment. As always, please feel free to share your story of how the hobby somehow has enriched your life. It doesn't have to be painting miniatures. It can be absolutely anything. Maybe it's just a certain game that has pulled you and your loved ones together over the years, and you'd like to share that with us. Please feel free to email me at the email that's listed right here. Put in the subject line, The Canvas, and I'll be in touch. See you next time.
Hi, I'm Jeremiah Acevedo, known as the Board Game Renegade on Instagram and YouTube, and welcome to the very first Taking Out the Trash. In this segment, I will be recommending Ameritrash games that I believe make excellent travel games. And along the way, I'll be giving you tips on how you can make some of your favorite Ameritrash games a little more travel friendly. Because if you're anything like I am, you like taking games with you wherever you go. I take games with me to the beach, to visit sick family members at the hospital, to visit my parents. I take them practically everywhere. So without further ado, let me give you my first travel recommendation, and that is King of Tokyo. King of Tokyo is a great Yahtzee-style dice-chucking game that supports 2-6 players and plays out in about 30 minutes, and that's why I like taking it with me wherever I go, because it's easy to teach and you can play it in such a short amount of time. And check out the box. The box isn't that big. This is a standard-sized backpack, and check it out. It could fit right into there. However, I like maximizing my space a little more and making games a little more efficient to take with me. So let me give you some tips on how to do so with this game. I like the artwork on the box of King of Tokyo, but when I travel with it, I leave it at home because it doesn't affect the gameplay whatsoever. I want to show you this, rules and rule books in general. If you're very familiar with a game and have played it 1,000 times, there's no need for you to take the rule book. It's just going to take up space. Or better yet, go to your mobile device and download the PDF rules or the rules in any format, so that way you can have the rules with you in case any questions occur. So here are all the game components of King of Tokyo, and you obviously don't want to take all of this stuff and just dump it into a backpack. So let's see what we can do with all of this to make it a little more travel friendly. To keep the cards from spilling all over the place, I like to put a rubber band softly around them. I don't put the rubber band on too tightly because it would ruin the integrity of the cards, and I don't want that to happen. And for King of Tokyo, rubber bands are also good to keep the character standees together, and also to keep the monster boards from spilling all over the place. Alright, you may not agree with me with this one, but I'm going to mention it anyway because it is absolutely true. The board in King of Tokyo is pretty much useless. There are only two locations on the board, Tokyo City and Tokyo Bay. You could just take two spots on the table and designate those spots, Tokyo City and Tokyo Bay, and that way you can leave the board at home, saving you even more space. My last tip is to place the components in a plastic baggie so that all of the pieces are together and they don't have to be loose inside of your bag. The bag is also waterproof, so if you get caught in the rain, your components will not be damaged. Now let's compare that to the box. As you can see, you have saved a lot of space, okay? You've saved a lot of space. This box is huge, and this fits into a cargo pant pocket. And even if you decide to take the board with you, you can place the board inside of this quart-sized baggie, and it is still more space efficient than carrying the game in the box. So I hope you enjoyed my travel game recommendation and my little tips. Once again, I am the Board Game Renegade, and until next time, peace out.
Some of my greatest gaming memories came from playing Ameritrash or thematic games. And it's not necessarily because I won or lost, but it's how I won or lost, or maybe the memory is from the social interaction that thematic games can create. Regardless, I know that one common thread that binds these memories together is immersion. Immersion is defined as the act of immersing someone or something in a liquid. Wait, what? Immersion is defined as a method of teaching a foreign language by the exclusive use of that language, usually in a special school. Nope. Immersion is defined as the state of being deeply engaged or involved. One of the goals of thematic games is to create an environment that the players can get invested in. There needs to be a world, a backdrop, or a story that will draw players in. Then mechanics can be added that will gamify the whole experience. See, it's the merging of a good theme and a good game mechanics that can create experiences that you will talk about long after the game is over. Here's an example. Dead of Winter from Plaid Hat Games is built around a very recognizable theme. The world is being overrun by zombies. Players control individuals who work together in order to survive the apocalypse. The mechanics of the game require players to work with each other towards collecting food to feed the colony, find needed supplies, and fight off the zombie hordes. But the game also provides random secret end goals for each player to achieve, and one of those goals might make somebody a traitor. So this mechanic adds a social element to a game where you start questioning people's actions and motives. Take all those elements, put them together, and you have a game that creates an environment for some memorable experiences. Another way to achieve immersion is to take on more of a personal role of a player in the game. For example, in games such as Descent, Arkham Horror, Zombicide, and Pandemic Legacy, you are taking on the role of an individual in the game. In these examples, each character has their own unique traits and capabilities, which can create some great dynamics in the game with other players. As you play the game, you get vested in these characters because you're making decisions for them, such as changing abilities and skills. And in some of these games, those characters can even die. See, it's not a far stretch from comparing a thematic game to a role-playing game. Think about it like this. In an RPG, you play as a character making decisions in a game. As you play, you put yourself in the position of that character, deciding on how they will act, what skills they will use, etc. But the difference between a thematic game and an RPG is that thematic games are typically more structured, and there is a definite end game where players can win or lose. Oh, I forgot. Another similarity between RPGs and many Ameritrash games is the use of dice. I should have thought of that D4. Hey, Game Master, I would like to make a humor check on that last pun, please. Crap. Also, RPGs are known for long campaigns that are played over multiple sessions. Recently, there have been a lot of thematic games designed to work the same way. For example, in Descent, you play as a character that grows and changes with each game session. and each session is a story that is part of a larger campaign. So now you're invested in a character that you'll be playing over and over, and that investment results in some very memorable moments. Theme, mechanics, social interaction, and character development all help create an immersive environment. And it's that deep attachment to the game that creates some gaming memories that will remain with you for a very long time. In the next segment, I'll cover one way theme can pull you into a game, and that's when the theme is based on intellectual property. But until next time, here's hoping that your next thematic game will be drowned in memories. Humor check. Crap.
Awesome sauce. We're going to talk some more strategy here. And since I'm feeling the Force, I want to stick with Star Wars games again. After I did Rebellion last time, now I want to do Star Wars Queen's Gambit. And I'm going to talk a little bit about Star Wars Risk as well, because that's the newer updated version of Star Wars Queen's Gambit, the one that's available in print. But in Star Wars Queen's Gambit, you have four areas. And I think no matter which side you are, you want to focus on the Jedi battle. If you're Darth Maul, you need to kill Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon. If you're Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon, you need to kill Darth Maul, because whichever one escapes that is going to come in and start affecting the palace. That, to me, is the most important thing in the game. No matter which side you are, you need to win that Jedi battle. You need to focus cards on the Jedi battle as much as you can. In addition, Anakin. Anakin is very important, because if the Obi-Wan Princess Amidala side can get Anakin through, all the droids disappear. So the droids need to make sure to put cards to stop Anakin as much as possible, because once Anakin gets there, the game is over for the droids. Darth Maul can still come in and do stuff, but you need to focus on that, because Anakin can just rush through and do nothing else. Which of course means that the palace battle and the Gungan battle are not as important. Of course they're still important, because they give you bonus cards, but they're not as important at the beginning of the game. They're something you need to focus on later. Of course, as the robot side, at the Trade Federation side, you're going to focus on those robots, because you have an advantage in those battles and you can get the extra cards. So you will put some forces on the good guy side, the Amidala side. You're never going to focus on those. You might focus a little, but you don't focus too much, because if you do, you're going to lose in the areas that are more important. So that's where I would say to focus. Now in Star Wars Risk, which is basically the same kind of game, you have three areas as well. The most important area for the Rebel Alliance is, of course, getting Han Solo and Princess Leia to knock out the shield, which is similar to the Anakin thing. You also have the lightsaber battle, which is just as important. Not as important as in Queen's Gambit, because in this lightsaber battle, you get extra cards if Luke wins or if Darth Vader wins, but you don't get a piece that can come and affect other parts of the game. So it's not quite as important. I wouldn't focus as much attention on it, but the middle, the space battle, is very important. That's probably the most important part, in addition to knocking out the shield generator, is the space battle. Because if you lose your pieces in the space battle, you have nothing that could attack. So the Empire side wants to build lots of TIE fighters, keep coming out in waves and knocking out the Rebellion fleet, because your TIE fighters keep coming back. The Rebels, on the other hand, need to make sure that they could wipe out enough TIE fighters to get in to eventually blow up the Death Star. And to me, it is another factor that you have to focus on when you're looking at the strategy. So that's my strategy segment this week. I looked at Star Wars Queen's Gambit and Risk Star Wars, two games in the same vein, and two games that I hope that this will help you when you bring it to the table and play it for yourself.
Hey guys, this is Roy Cannaday with Epic Gaming Night, and this is Roll with the Punches, where we talk about randomness in games and how it can make games exciting and how to mitigate the randomness into your favor. This week we're going to be talking about how randomness can make games exciting. There's all sorts of games that utilize randomness, tons of games behind me. A lot of these American-style games use dice and random events and all sorts of things that make games exciting when you flip over cards and see what's happening. So I'm just going to talk about a few examples here. In Battlestar Galactica, as a human, you're hoping with every single one of those event cards that randomly come up that they have the jump prep track on there that will move the jump prep track so that you can further the colony along that prep track, because the more times you jump, the more cards you get that help you to win the game. So every single time one of those cards come up, you're like, well, if it's bad, it sucks, but hopefully at least it can help us go along the jump prep track. And then furthermore on that, the game feels like it always comes down to the situation where you're right on the edge of the jump prep track and you can jump the ship if you hit the FTL, and if you have to roll the dice to try to see if you lose population or not, because your bow star jumps away and loses a whole bunch of the ships behind. If you lose too many population, you lose the game, and it's like you get down to that last second, and it makes it super exciting on when the one die roll is going to determine whether you win or lose the game. And there's ways you can even mitigate that. There's cards that give you like +2 to the dice and stuff like that if you play it at the specific time. So there's all sorts of awesome things with that, and every single time we play Battlestar Galactica, it's like that tense moment when you're like, oh my gosh, what's going to happen? Are we going to make it? Are we going to lose? And there's other games like Eldritch Horror where there's just tons of event cards where there's just completely random things, and you're going through gates and like doing these weird other world encounters and just reading the weirdness on the card. It's always exciting to see because you never really know what's going to happen on those event cards. And that's one of the charms of the game, is just exploring events and exploring different locations all around the map to see what happens and the story that unfolds from that. So that's super exciting. There's also games like Legendary where the last scheme twist, if it comes out of the deck, we're gonna lose, and everyone's cooperating together and scrambling up and hoping that that card doesn't come out, and the randomness just adds to the how tense the game is and how much it makes you feel like it's exciting. Because for me, if I play a game and everything's known and everything's the same, I mean, they can still be fun, but the excitement sometimes is not there. I mean, randomness adds a whole lot of flavor and excitement and can add highly thematic elements into games. So that's why I like randomness in games, because there's so much that can go on and so many mechanics that designers can use to make the game random and exciting for the players. So check us out next time on Roll With The Punches. We'll see you then.
Hi guys, it's Breach18 and I'm here in Nottingham's very own board game cafe, the Dice Cup. And last time we was talking about Ameritrash games and whether you'd be more likely to play an Ameritrash game based on the way it looks, the artwork, over, say, a Euro game. So let's go chat to the people and the local gamers of the Dice Cup. Hi guys, you alright? Do you want to introduce yourselves?
I'm Charlotte.
I'm Claudemir.
So if I give you that game, and I give you that game, would you just like to tell me a little bit about what your initial impression is of the game and whether you would want to play it or not, or whether you'd actually choose to play the other game?
It looks like Call of Duty meets Farscape. It's a little bit, I don't know. It doesn't really look like my kind of thing.
Okay, fair enough.
I'll be honest.
Yep.
Play this one?
I'd play that one because it looks French.
Okay, so you actually prefer the look of that game over to this one. And what about you? Would you say this game you like the better? You like the look of it better? Or
I think I'd probably play this game.
You'd play that game as well. Wow. Okay, that's cool. So you'd actually, in this case, you'd both go for the Euro game. So that's really, really interesting. Thank you, guys. Hi guys, if you'd like to introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Sam.
I'm Chris.
Excellent. Okay, you'd like to take this one.
Thank you.
And if you would like to take this one. And what I would like to know is, out of these two games, which would you most like to play, or which would you prefer to play, and why?
This one.
XCOM, okay. Is that because you know the computer game XCOM, or just...
No. It just looks more exciting, which I guess is the point of the cover, but it does look more exciting.
Okay, and how about you?
That one.
That one, right. Okay, and purely because it looks more exciting, whereas this one...
Yeah, I want to know more about that one, where they seem to have it all on the box.
Right, okay, so you think that this explains what the game's about better than this one, so this is kind of like slightly more intriguing?
Yeah.
Okay. Hi guys, if you'd just like to introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Alex.
And I'm Kim.
Hi. I will give one to you.
Thank you.
And I shall give one to you. So, out of these two games, which would you prefer to play? And why, basically?
I'd probably prefer to play that one, purely because I've played games like this today and they've been a lot harder to understand.
Okay.
So, yeah.
I think that's quite a good point, because I think
there's that kind of screams out a little bit more kind of difficulty to the game. And I think, yeah, and I think this one, especially for my target, like for my age group, this would seem a little bit more appealing than one where the writing looks a little bit kind of old-fashioned and a little
bit. So yeah, I completely get what you're saying. So this to you would put you off purely because it looks maybe a bit more difficult to play or to learn to pick up.
Yeah, like
so,
there'd be more instructions to it and not more things that you'd need to know.
Okay, so this looks more friendly in terms of the sort of entry-level gamer.
I think you should get on with it pretty much straight away.
Okay, that's interesting to know. So you both would pick that one, and that's purely based on the artwork.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Okay, so out of the six people I asked, two people actually preferred the artwork of the Euro game, and that would be their preference of game between the two options that they were given. The rest, however, did go for the Ameritrash game based on first initial impressions of the artwork. So that was really interesting and pretty much reaffirmed my initial impressions of what would happen. So what can we take from this? Well, obviously this is a loose question and I only asked six people, so it's not exactly a big pool of people to actually take statistics away from. But it's definitely interesting that people's first impressions are actually on the artwork. And also, there was a comment that was made about the complexity of the game and that the artwork of the Euro game made them feel like the game would be harder to learn and harder to pick up, which isn't actually necessarily the case in terms of Euro games via Ameritrash games. I know plenty of Ameritrash games are actually quite difficult to get into, and vice versa, there are some Euro games that are actually pretty simple to pick up. So what will I be asking next time is, at what point does a Ameritrash game become a hybrid of the two? But I'm also asking you guys at home, so put your notes in the comment section below. Thank you guys for watching Café Chat and enjoy the rest of your lunch.
Throat Punchies, I'm Forrest from Bower's Game Corner. I'm back again for three reasons where I spotlight a game outside of the top 1,000 that I still love and I think you might want to check out. And this week I'm very excited to be talking about Walk the Plank from Mayday Games. This is from Shane Steely and Jared Tinney, and this is actually the spiritual successor to Get Bit, the immensely popular Get Bit. However, this one was not nearly as popular and didn't have nearly as much staying power, and I feel like it should, and I'm going to give you three reasons why. The first reason is because this is what I like to call a chameleon game. It's a very versatile game, and these are the kind of games I'd love to have in my collection. You're looking for a game night filler game? Look no further. Walk the Plank fills that bill. You're looking for a family game? This one is great. I'd say ages 7 plus can easily play this. You're looking for a gateway game? Walk the Plank is not intimidating, easy to learn, easy to teach, always a good thing. You're looking for a great game night with another couple where you're sipping wine? This will fit the bill. It's a chameleon game. Love it for that aspect. Reason number two, the theme comes across and it fits the gameplay. You feel like a pirate and you're pushing people and shoving people back to the boat and trying to get them into Davy Jones' locker. And the mechanisms in the game and the quickness and how speedy this game is make the theme come across, which I love when a game is able to successfully pull that off, and well, that's exactly what a great Ameritrash game should be doing. Last but not least, the components. In order to have a great Ameritrash game, at least in my theme, you need to have good components, and this one fits the bill. Davy Jones' locker, they don't even need that, but they included this awesome little round monster guy who's like, ah! And the meeples are not just regular meeples, they're little pirates with pirate hats, and the artwork is great and cartoonish, and it just all works together. So Walk the Plank, it's a little bit older now, I think it's about 3 years old now. Don't let this one fly off your radar, if that's even an expression. Walk the Plank, a game that I highly recommend you go back and check out. Let me know what you think about it in the comments below, and as always, back to more Throat Punchy goodness.
Hey Hey everybody, I'm Kat Jackson with the Hobby Hangout here. I am a professional artist with CK Studios, and I'm also the host of the Hobby Hangout Online, a Facebook group where artists around the world get together and share in Hangouts ideas and inspire each other. I'm going to do an answer to a bunch of inquiries I got after the first segment, which is, what are the things you need to do, need to collect to get going on your hobby here? First of all, you're going to want to pick your model. And so some of the examples we have for the models you're going to find in the games right now are some of the chibis. And I'm going to say go out there and pick some of these. Arcadia Quest, Super Dungeon Explorer, those types of games have really great little chibis that you can work off of. Take and require no building. If you do want to go into building, you can go in with something like Scale 75, which has their Smog Rider series. Really cool. They come with an instruction booklet, tells you what paints you need, tells you how to apply them, and how to get going. Some of the tools you're going to need right off the bat. You're going to need nippers for clipping. These nippers are under $10. You're going to find them at your hobby store. You're going to find them at your hardware store. You're going to need a hobby knife. A hobby knife is going to allow you to trim down all the seam lines on your models. Whether or not they're straight off of a sprue or if they're out of the Arcadia Quest box, they're going to have seam lines. The next thing you're going to need is your glue. Lots of different varieties out there. You really just need something that's going to attach to plastic. Your super basic super glue really does work well. I'm going to tell you the key is to get something with a long neck on it, because the thinner the application tube, the easier it is to use. The next thing you're going to need are going to be some files. Files will help you kind of smooth out any of the irregularities in your model. Metal files work fine. Emery board type files work fine. You'll find these also at your hobby store or hardware store. You'll need a little bit of blue tack. Have some of this available to you at all times. I'll explain why in a second. Have something that will help you pick up small pieces. I love having tweezers with handles on them. The next thing that we're going to need is our basic brushes. Our basic brushes, get going out the gate. Don't go out and buy a whole bunch of really expensive brushes. You can get your acrylic brushes straight from the hobby store. These are going to run you. This was a $6 pack for five brushes, so a little over a dollar each. This is a little more expensive because it's one of the actual hobby brand lines, and that's going to run you probably about $10. You're going to need some brush cleaner to take care of these brushes. The cake style is my favorite, and it lasts for years. Grab yourself a water glass. I'm going to give you a hint here. Don't make it a coffee cup. You'll end up dipping it every time. Make it something that's not relatively the same as your coffee cup. I've used both of these for about 20 years. The next thing you're going to need is a palette. I use a wet palette. We'll go into another part of another segment where I actually talk to you about what a wet palette is, but this allows us to actually preserve our paints. Paper plate that's plastic coated works just fine. You can start there. We'll go into wet palettes later on, but you will need a palette. You'll need a pile of paper towels. And you're going to need a good surface to paint on, because you're working with glue, you're working with paints, and you're going to need to keep whatever you're working on clean. This happens to be a cutting mat, and it saves every surface I'm working on from my knife as well. The next thing you're going to need is some primer. Before you start painting anything, you have to prime your models. You have to put a surface down that allows for the acrylic paint to adhere to the plastic. So this will allow us to get our actual paint on there. The next thing you're going to need is something to hold on to your models with so that you don't have to hold on to it by hand. I made a pill bottle one, wrapped it in gauze. It's got actual pills in it, and then I used the blue tack on top of it, kind of like this, which is just a cheap little shot glass from the store. I have a work in progress model right here. You can see she's just sitting on top of it. I can hang on to it and not her. Your corks from your wine bottles and your big beer bottles work just fine as well. So that's some hints and some tips about what you need to actually get going. Shoot me some more emails. This segment was, I literally built this off of all the feedback I got from the original introduction, from folks saying, I've never done it before, interested in starting, what do I actually need to have to get going? And that's about it. It's not a huge investment. You can get going with all your hardware and gear and stuff for probably under $30, and you can have a really good time. So happy painting, everybody out there. As we say at CK Studios, come paint with us.
Hey there, folks. Welcome back to Conflict Corner. Today we'll be talking a little bit about how miniatures get onto my table, back to the box, and then back to another table so that people can play them. It usually just ends up like this. People ask me to paint their games. I get a pile on my my painting table, and then I basically start up from there. I decide I will end up trying to tackle the easiest of figures that I can do, mostly in a conveyor belt style, like Zombicide. Most of those zombies were pretty easy to paint. You're probably wondering why you've never seen any of my work, and you probably actually have, you just don't know it. I have painted a set for Jason. He's on this video series, and perhaps Jason will go ahead and show off his Small World designer set, hint hint Jason. So I also said that I was going to go ahead and answer some strategy questions that I saw in the comments that perhaps some of you had left, and I did notice that there was a user who had commented about the game Shadowrun. I unfortunately haven't played Shadowrun yet, but hopefully somebody will bring it to Dice Tower, the Dice Tower convention, and I can play it there and be able to give you some tips and tricks of how to play that. So the second question came to me from a viewer, Zippy Star, about Kemet. He said that the best strategy that he's noticed in a lot of his games has been to go for the level 3 white upgrade that allows you to roll your pyramids at the end of the night phase up one level. He said that this has become so much of a strategy that they've actually started to remove it from the game. We've actually played, pretty much every time I've played Kemet, we played with the beginner rule set where it says that you can't buy over the first or second tiers until that second night phase. Now, what that does is limits new players into trying to race with veteran players. I'm not sure if everyone in your table is a veteran player or not, but in that case, if you wanted to tweak it even more, which what I have written down here, you could actually do one level each of the rounds. So for that second round, you can only buy ones and twos. Now, obviously, this is going to drag out the game a lot longer because you're going to have to wait till that fourth round. And by that fourth round, hopefully, someone's got a pyramid that they've already leveled up to level 4. I feel like if you decided to remove a tile from the game, it's sort of like trying to fight with an arm tied behind your back. I suggest starting a pyramid at level 2 versus a 3 level 1s. And I'm not sure if you play this way with a level 2 white pyramid so you guys can start getting your points that way. But mostly my starting is a level 2 red pyramid and a level 1 white pyramid, and one of my first actions in that first phase is to get that level that red pyramid up to level 3 so I can start buying better monsters. Well, that's all the time I have today. The next video I'm actually going to be covering Kemet and Blood Rage, the similarities and differences in those area control card games.
This is Tim Jennette, the Metal Meeple, and this is the Miniature Breakdown. So in this episode of the Miniature Breakdown, we're going to take a deeper look at War Machine, but mostly about the uniqueness of the game and what it brings to the table that's different than other miniature games. It's a 30mm hobby miniature game, so you do have to buy the models, assemble them, and paint them. It's designed and published by Privateer Press. It's more of a skirmish level game, so you're going to have about 15 to 30 models depending on the point limit that you set and what faction you choose to bring to the table. Most like miniature game, or just like miniature games, you're going to put all your things on one side of the table, your opponent puts all his stuff on the other side, and you take turns moving your entire force and doing actions with them. Now, what sets this game super apart from most games is the fact of your war caster and his battle group of warjacks. Now, a war caster, such as Lord Commander Stryker here, is going to be your most valuable piece. The reason is because the standard scenario of the game is if your warcaster dies, you lose the game. So you're trying to assassinate the opponent's warcaster. You don't even have to do damage to the rest of their team if you don't want. On top of that, you got, like I said, warjacks. These warjacks are super powerful, but they're not as powerful as they can be So in order to do that, you need focus. Before we do that, each model is going to come with cards that dictate their stats and their weapons and things like that. Units are going to have one card for their whole unit, but most of them are going to have a card per model. Warcasters actually have this focus. Now, this focus is pretty important because focus allows you each turn to assign points to either your warjacks and your battle group. So in this case, you can assign points out to your warjacks, and then anything you have left over, you can do various things with, but more importantly, you can cast spells. These spells allow you to combo and synergize different things. You can actually put AoEs on the ground, you can buff units and things like that. But obviously, if you give out too much focus, then you don't have enough for spells. So you can see how it's like a more of a resource management game in that instance. Now, the way combat works, and I'm going to explain that before I talk about what you use this focus for, but combat is always 2 6-sided die, add it to one of your stats, or like a melee stat or a ranged stat, and you equal or defeat the opponent's defense. Once you've done that, then you roll again, adding the strength of your weapon to the die roll, and anything that goes above their armor actually does damage. Most guys have one hit point. Warjacks actually have a whole damage grid in which you're going to draw columns down. You'll roll a die in whatever column you go down. So you can see the letters down here, like their left arm and right arm, cortex and movement. So as they suffer damage, their systems become crippled and they're not as efficient. Anyway, like I said, you're going to roll 2d6. And then you're going to add it to an ability stat and compare it. Well, say, for instance, you don't have enough. This is where, or you're not going to roll very well, or you need something really high. This is where focus comes into play. You spend focus to actually add another die. On top of that, you can also, if, you know, say, for instance, you're easily hitting and doing tons of damage, you can spend focus to actually do more attacks. Normally, you're going to get one attack per weapon and things like that. So, lastly, I'm going to talk about is what's called a feat. Warcasters bring to the table a feat, which is a completely broken ability, but everybody gets one. But the caveat is you can only use it once a game. And that's what really sets the game apart, is to pick the feat that you synergize your team with and everything and try to annihilate the opponent's Warcaster. So next episode, I think we're going to talk about the different factions and what you can expect. They do have different play styles and things like that. And until next time, keep on rocking and rolling dice.
Hey everybody, Georgie here from Beards and Board Games, and today I'm here with my segment which I'm calling The Past, the Present and the Future. Now, focusing on the past this week, I'm going to talk about, to this day, probably one of my favourite cooperative games and certainly one of the most thematic games that I've ever played, and that is Lord of the Rings by Rainer Knizia, which was released in 2000. Now, the game plays from 2 to 5 players, and it's, like I said, a fully cooperative game, probably one of the first, if not the first, fully cooperative game, and it really, really feels like you are the hobbits going through all the adventures and the sorrows that they did. The game involves like a card mechanism where you're playing cards to move along certain paths, and also involves a tile flipping mechanism, being the results of those tiles and a cooperative game, a lot of it really, really negative. So you can move down like an event track, which again is very, very negative and can affect all the players in a negative way. And the aim of the game is to try and get through all the land and get to the end of Mordor before A, the event tracks are going down on each side of the board, or the hobbits itself are consumed by the darkness of Sauron. Like I said, the theme really drips out of this game. The Sauron figure is probably one of the sweetest minis that I've still seen to this day. It doesn't look like it's taken much work to make, but it's a really, really sweet mini. So that's Lord of the Rings, and that's The Past. And I'll be back next time with The Present.
Hello everyone, welcome to Miniature World. Well, like I said in our last episode, we were going to talk about under the radar type of companies and miniature games and so forth and so on. And I think this one fits both, and that's Spartan Games. Now, some of you may know who they are. They did produce Halo Fleet Battles, which is a very good game. they've also done a lot of really great things to try to get people into the miniature hobby. And number one is they're known for Dytopian Wars, which is a great game. And they put together these wonderful, wonderful box sets where you have everything in them. And the story to it is very, very deep, where you're, where aliens land in the Antarctic, and back in the old steam engine days, kind of steampunkish, and they take over, and people discover their technology and start to adhere it to all their machinery. But what really makes this special is that these box sets that tell a story, and they come with unique pieces that you can only get in the box sets. And you get everything in the box. You get the rules, dice, everything that you can matter, and two armies to battle with. They're also known for Firestorm Armada, and they've really been doing a wonderful job with their latest, which is Firestorm Planetfall, which is the ground game to Firestorm Armada. Another great box set where all you do is open up the box. There are very little putting things together. The miniatures are just wonderful. Why don't we go down to the table and take a look at some of the miniatures, and you can see what great quality they have and how underrated this company really is. Now right here, I've got some miniatures that are painted up from Dytopian Wars, and I really wanted to show these off because I really want you guys to see how beautifully detailed these models are. And you could see that they really have a just a wonderful, wonderful detail, a wonderful feel to them, all the way down to, as you can see, almost each one of those planks are just individually done, and they're made out of a beautiful, beautiful resin. Because if you look underneath, all this is just that very good resin. And this here is actually from a box. This is a you can buy an entire fleet box, which will come with three planes, some freighters and stuff, and it all works out into giving you a starter army right off. And this is the British, the United Kingdom, as they call it. Some of the box sets are just really, really amazing. And you know, the most impressive thing is that every miniature that they've ever done is just absolutely drop dead gorgeous. And I just don't think they get the credit that they deserve for some of these wonderful, wonderful, wonderful miniatures that they put out. And the game plays very, very well using an exploding dice mechanism. It even gets down to the fighter component level. Very, very high quality miniatures. And I just don't think that they get the credit that they do. But hopefully you guys will check them out and really give them some love. So let's send it up top and call it a day. So there you have it, Spartan Games. As you could see, beautiful, gorgeous miniatures, wonderful mechanisms that they have. I hope you guys will go to their website, www.spartangames.uk. Check them out. I think you might be surprised at how great their games really are. That's it for this week. We'll see you next segment for Miniature World. Until then, I'm Rob Oren. We'll see you soon.
So that about does it for episode 2 of Throat Punch Lunch. Certainly hope that you enjoyed all of the contributors. I know that I did, and I am very thankful for all of them for putting on all that hard work, putting their segments together. So I hope that you continue to come back every other week and basically honor them with watching their segments. I certainly do appreciate it. Next time on episode 3, we're going to have another contributor adding to the fold here, and I think you'll be very happy with the segments that he will provide. So come back on episode 3 to see who that new mystery contributor is. But he's a very popular YouTuber, and he has graciously accepted my invitation to provide a segment every month. So that's about it. Thanks so much for joining us, and hey, we will see you on the flip side.
Thanks so much for watching the Dice Tower videos. Find more great videos and reviews, as well as our top-rated audio podcast at Dicetower.com. You can also find other great shows at Dicetowernetwork.com. I'm Eric Summerer, and you've been watching The Dice Tower. The Dice Tower is sponsored by Cool Stuff, Inc., where you can find great games for great prices. Cool stuff in stock. Check them out at CoolStuffInc.com.
My spleen!